Welcome to this service and Merry Christmas. It's wonderful to be here with you. It's wonderful to be with you online as well. And what a season. What a season to celebrate and acknowledge and sing about God with us, Emmanuel. Anyway, what a blessing. What a blessing. Listen to this psalm. It's a perfect psalm for today. The psalmist just goes nuts, saying, praise God for everything. Everybody in the whole creation, praise God. Listen to this, 148. Praise God from the heavens. Praise God in the heights. Praise God, all the angels. Praise God, all the host. Praise God, sun and moon. Praise God, all you shining stars. Praise God, you highest heavens and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of God who commanded and they were created, who established them forever and ever and fixed their bounds which cannot be passed. Praise God from the earth, you sea monsters and all deeps, fire and hail and snow and frost, stormy wind fulfilling God's command, mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all cattle, creeping things, flying birds, monarchs of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and women alike, old and young together, let them praise the name of God, whose name alone is exalted, whose glory is above earth and heaven, who has raised up a horn for the people, praise for all the faithful, the people of Israel who are close to God. Praise our God. So I want to just highlight a couple of things that are life and work type things, things that you ought to know if you're part of the congregation. And one is, you ought to know if you're part of the congregation or not, that you're welcome here. It doesn't matter whoever you are. If you've just stumbled across us online, this is Whitehorse in the Yukon, and we're Whitehorse United Church, and everybody's welcome here. And so it doesn't matter if you're officially part of this congregation. It's just a beautiful thing for us in our common humanity to be together in a place where we're seeking and willing to go to deep down places. So, but these are particularly, I think, things for Whitehorse United Church you might want to know. First of all, welcome to Jim and Brenda from Ontario. We've had so many delightful conversations with people who are home for the holidays or visiting for the holidays, but welcome to you. So this week in particular, the office will be closed. So if you need, you just need to know that. Bible study will continue on Zoom as usual. We've received lots of greetings from many of you who have sent cards and letters and emails and so on, and thank you for all of those. The only other thing I want to say, I think, is that if you have, thank you so much for your kindness and generosity to me. So many people have sent cards and gifts and emails and greetings, and I appreciate every single one of them. If I haven't said thank you to you for a particular thing, it's because I haven't opened anything yet. When Christmas Day is Saturday, it also means the next day is Sunday, which means I'm writing. So I decided yesterday that today would be my Christmas Day. All of that is to say I haven't opened a thing. So if you're thinking, why didn't she say thank you for it? That's because I haven't opened it. Okay. I think that's it. And let's listen to the prelude again. Thank you. And none shall be afraid. That's that repeating line. Isn't that a good one? And none shall be afraid. Today, we're going to meet two people in the temple in Jerusalem. Almost all other stories in Luke are set outside the temple. This one is right there inside. For one of the people we'll meet, the temple was home. She lived there. After she had been widowed, it was her home. That's a pretty good expression for a place of worship, a home, a cradle, a nest, a holding place. It can form you and challenge you. A place where we can hold tight to in the wildest of dreams, or more truly, let those dreams hold tightly to us. A place where we can seek and sometimes stop the seeking, because we know that the glory, in fact, has a way of finding us. And sometimes all we have to do is be still and let ourselves be found. Not in some fuzzy, romanticized past or a possible future, but like right now. A home where glory finds us. And I'm not talking about making an idol of a building, although, especially at Christmas time in a place you love, like this one, this is tempting, but no. Not that, because we know that the glory is everywhere. God, Emmanuel, is everywhere. But wherever it is that people meet to praise and worship, each of the characters in the Christmas story meets the holy in the place that's just right for them. For Joseph, it was in his dreams. For the shepherds, it was while they were at work. And for Zechariah, the same. The shepherds were out in the field, and Zechariah just happened to be assigned to go into the Holy of Holies that day. For Elizabeth, it was in the sound of a young girl's greeting. For the Magi, it was in their studies. They were scientists of their day, studying the night sky, and so on. God finds us, God speaks to us in the ways and in the places we're most likely to hear and be willing to listen. Today, we meet two people who meet the truth, who meet the thing they've been waiting for all their lives, and they meet that in the temple. And I don't know where that place is for you. Maybe here? I don't know. We're going to light the candles now. We're going to light them for hope and peace and joy and love. And then we're going to light for God with us, Emmanuel. And then we're going to see what happens. And now we're going to sing Joy to the World. It's 59. Thank you. And let's pray. God, for this moment, we give you thanks. For this day and for every day. Every day a celebration of your love with us, your presence, not somewhere far away, but right here in human flesh, in all flesh. We thank you for this opportunity to be together, for this sanctuary where some of us are meeting, for the wonders of technology that allow us to meet with so many others right now, and for your mystery that unites us. Not only with these right now, but with the ancient ones, and with those yet to come. Not limited by geography, not limited by the brokenness of relationships, not limited by anything, not even death. Because we know that there is nothing that can keep us apart truly. Thank you for this moment. May we be open, hearts open, ears open, eyes open, and then finally hands and hearts open as we leave this place. But for now, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. The carol is 47. So I need to say a couple of other things that I should have said earlier. One is thank you to Joanne for playing for us today. And yes, for sure. And also, if you are wondering what the logic is behind the carols I've chosen, there is none. I know that people have their favorite carols and you can't squish them all into Christmas Eve, even though I tried. And so we're kind of singing the carols that we didn't get a chance to sing on Christmas Eve. That's my theory. Okay. Luke chapter 2. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration, and it was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own hometowns to be registered, and Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David. He went there to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to be delivered. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. Carol 58. In that region were shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And then an angel of God stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "What? For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord, and this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom God favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go and see what has taken place, which God has made known to us." So they went with haste, and they found the child, Mary and Joseph, and the child was lying in a manger. And when they saw this, they made known what had been told them about the child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen. It was exactly as it had been told them. You know what I think is the funniest line in that? The shepherds are there. There's a sky full of angels singing glory to God in the highest heaven. It's like they're saying, "Can we have a sign?" "What more? What would you like?" "Here's a sign. Not that. You're going to find a baby wrapped in swaddling bands and lying in a manger. That's the sign." Anyway, I'm not preaching on that, but I just had to say that because I can't say it again till next year. Okay, we're going to sing two carols in a row. Do you think we can do it?
Sure.
Okay, so 48 and then 44. So, this is continuing exactly where we just left off in Luke. So the shepherds just went home and they were glorifying God and telling everybody. After 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child, and he was called Jesus, the name given to him by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to God. As it is written in the law of God, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to God. And they offered sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of Moses, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen God's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's mother and father were amazed at what was being said about him, and then Simeon blessed them. And then said to his mother, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your soul also." There was also a prophet, Anna, daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. And at that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. So, before we meet again next Sunday, 2021 will be history. Are you saying thank goodness? It's like, yeah, I know. And we'll have begun a new year, and there are lots of jokes about that, about how eager we'll be to see the backside of this year, and looking forward to 2022. Either that, or with everything that's happened, kind of wondering, okay, what's going to happen? You know, what's next? But most of us are looking to the new, anticipating a better year, a brighter future than this year has been, at least hoping it will be so. And you know that image of the classic image of the old year as an old man, white beard spent, and a chubby baby new year just born? This is kind of perfect for that text. Luke is the only one who gives us this story, but it's a classic. The very old in the evening of their lives. There's a great line in a Miriam Therese Winter carol for Advent about Mary going to see Elizabeth. And one of the lines is, "Fresh as the flower on the first ray of dawn, she went to her cousin whose mourning was gone." I just find that beautiful as I come to the place where my mourning is gone, you know? And there are, anyway, it's beautiful. Luke plays on that image a lot, the very old and the very young, the newly born at the dawn of their life, together in a moment of revelation, of clarity, of feeling deep, deep inside the wholeness of life, its rhythms and patterns and contradictions and its glory. It's beautiful, the very old and the very young together. There's something about that. I don't know if you were watching the 9 o'clock service on Christmas Eve. Did you see the pictures of our old Elizabeth and the brand new baby? Anyway, We saw that first in Luke with Elizabeth and Zechariah, remember? Old people unable to bear children, and then, bam, Elizabeth is postmenopausal and gloriously pregnant. And then Elizabeth standing there with Mary. The old and the young together in contrast, but in kind of a, I don't know, heavenly harmony, the old and the young, the image repeats and repeats throughout the gospel. I think asking us, I mean, Luke knows what he's doing, asking us, what's our relationship to the past and how do we stand as the future approaches at the moment for us in the form of a new year about to begin? How do we position ourselves balanced precariously on this present moment when the past calls us back to nostalgia? People, you know, talking wistfully about, oh, remember the days when we didn't have to. And so the past calls us in lots of ways, and the future is uncertain and unclear. The old and the new together, where are we in that picture? That seems to be a theme. Luke shows us image after image, variations on a theme. If this was a piece of music, the melody would repeat and repeat and repeat. And here we are again this morning. And I want to hold up this reading. I want to hold up this reading. We're going to explore some of the background that helps us in understanding it. And I want to offer it as a gift as you move into this new year, where the old meets the new. So a little bit of background that may help. For Jewish people at that time, there were two things that had to be done after the birth of a firstborn male child. Number one, have him circumcised on the eighth day. And then take him to the temple where the mother would be purified and the baby presented to God. Mary and Joseph are doing what was required of them by their faith. They're standing in the tradition of their ancestors, giving thanks for the gift of a child, marking him in the most intimate physical way as belonging to God, as a child of the promise. It doesn't say about the circumcision. Did they stay in Bethlehem and go to a rabbi there for this ceremony 8 days later? By then, the city might have gone back to normal with the crowds going back home after the registration. Maybe there was lodging available, I don't know. And if they needed to, Joseph had marketable skills. They could have stayed there for a while, because if it had been uncomfortable for Mary getting to Bethlehem when she was 9 months pregnant, how much more uncomfortable would it have been to take that journey just after having given birth? Her body was young, it would heal, but it makes sense that they stayed, I don't know. And then after the required 33 days, gone to the temple from there. In any case, Luke isn't interested in any of that, telling us the details. He just wants to get them to the temple. And so we find ourselves with this little family in Jerusalem at the temple. Mary and Joseph had probably been there before, likely, because that's where Jews went for high holidays and ceremonies. But still, it must have been a breathtaking sight as they crested the Mount of Olives, and there it was, the brand new temple, finished only a few years before that by Herod's workforce, 6 city blocks long, we're told, that temple. Dazzling white in the sun, meant to take your breath away. This was their spiritual home. This was for Jews where heaven and earth meet. This was for them the place that God lives. And I wonder if they stopped just at the crest of the hill before they went down into the city and just looked at the site and maybe feed the baby. And I wonder if she sang to him as he nursed some of the old songs about Jerusalem. Praise God, how good is it to sing praises to our God. God builds up Jerusalem and gathers in the outcasts. God heals up the brokenhearted and binds up their wombs, and so on and so on. I wonder if she's singing to him and nursing, and he just absorbed that in a physical way from her. And she's holding in her arms, looking at that temple, she's holding in her arms the one who's going to challenge all that she saw before her. The temple stood, it embodied the law, authority, ritual, tradition, which are all good things that can and do get easily co-opted into serving something other than God. And then in every age, including our own, when that happens, when that twisting happens, the rituals, the traditions, the buildings are meant to open a dialogue, enable a dialogue between God and humans, to make space, literally, for a genuine encounter with the Holy One, and to provide a space and a way to give yourself to that encounter and then live as though it matters. And in every age, theirs and ours, we need prophets, those who shake things up when we've moved away from that intent. When our buildings and the practices associated with them serve something other than the gospel. We need prophets to tell us when our old ways are on the way out and something squirming and new is about to be born. I find myself wondering about those things as our own visioning committee wrestles with questions about this building, particularly the sanctuary, and asking if there are ways that this space can be adapted to serve the gospel more fully. And if you'd like to have that conversation, I'd love to hear your thoughts. Our newsletter has been sharing some of what the committee is thinking and exploring, but this needs to be a wide and robust conversation. Anyway, what's happening here right now feels like a very Lucan moment to me. Just one more image of the same thing, the old and the new. Another recurring image I won't go into really, but I have to point it out because I just can't not point it out, is that Luke often presents us with two people, a woman and a man, who together seem to embody the word at that moment. Elizabeth and Zechariah, Anna and Simeon, and later on, that would be a good sermon, not for today. And speaking of including women with men in his writing, here's one bit of background. Again, that has nothing to do with the text, but I can't not tell you. The law said at that time that after childbirth, a woman was ceremonially unclean, as at the time of her menstruation. If she had given birth to a boy, she would be considered unclean for 33 days. If she had given birth to a girl, take your wildest guess. 66. Double. That's food for a whole sermon, not today. So they're going to Jerusalem, Jesus' first trip there. It would not be his last. We know about his last. And this passage points to that one. They get there, they're finally in the temple grounds, they purchase the required offering, two small birds. They would be the sacrifice by which he was redeemed according to custom. On his last trip to Jerusalem, there would be no birds because he upset the tables of those who were selling them. No birds then. The only sacrifice then was himself. But for now, there were birds, and the law stated that the offering would be one lamb. But if the parents were poor, then two pigeons or doves. And this is the only thing that we always assume they were poor, but this, what they chose or what they purchased for an offering, confirms that. So they buy the birds, they enter more deeply into the temple space. To fulfill the law in this way is a joy and a joining of themselves to the ancient ones and to God. And they entered in holding the baby close. There were so many people. I'm guessing Mary was sort of, you know, and then this old guy comes up. This old man with a face deeply inhabited. You know, he was old. He approaches. He's not a priest. He just kind of comes up to them with wonder in his eyes. And I don't know, maybe he says, "Can I hold the baby?" Anyway, and she reluctantly hands him over. It wouldn't be the first time she has to let him go when every instinct in her says, "Hold on, protect him." She hands him, and the man takes him and walks a little away, The child seemed to move him to intense emotion, and he says, in essence, "Well, now I've seen everything, and I can die in peace." Says, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." He speaks of falling and rising, much like Mary's Magnificat, a reversal, an upheaval. And then he blesses them, not the child, but them. And then he speaks directly to Mary. If this were being filmed, the background noises would just stop and the crowd would fade away and the camera would be just on the three of them, a baby held in the arms of an old man whose cloudy eyes see now more clearly than they ever had. And he looks directly at the young mom who can't decide where to look, at her son or at this old man, and somehow they seem the same. And he speaks, I think it's in a whisper, and he says, "And a sword will pierce your heart too." I picture his voice as tender, almost wanting to protect her from what he needed to say. He tells her that her soul will be pierced. And then he hands back the baby and a little wistfully, reluctantly perhaps, walks away. And while she's still gathering the child to her and rearranging the blanket and still going, "Boo, what just happened?" Along comes an old woman, Anna, prophet. And she can't stop talking. She talks to everybody about the child. And whatever thoughts they had had of blending into that crowd are pretty much shot at this point. And whatever else this child would do, he would draw the crowd, and he would speak to the hearts of those who never thought that they'd live to see the like of this. He'd speak to the souls of the elders and speak with the voice of the ancient ones, so that pretty much anyone who spent time in his presence felt like Simeon, "Well, now I've seen everything. Now that I've seen this, now that I've been in the glow of this child and seen this glory, I'm ready to die, and more than that, I'm ready to live." May God bless you as you think about these things. Amen. Once, I don't know what Simeon and Anna did after that, but once you've been in the presence, once you've been in Jesus' presence, you want to share that. You want to share the good news. You want to share the peace and the love and the joy and the hope that that are just beaming off of him as a baby, we're told, and as an adult as well. And one of the ways we do that is by being generous and giving giving generous offerings. So I don't know what your heart is calling you to do as a generous response right now. There are so many ways to participate with God in the mending of this world. If you choose to participate by giving an offering to this church, then I thank you very much. And I promise you that we will receive them with thanks, and we'll deal with them with responsibility and faithfulness. We have good people who are managing that side of our ministry. So we don't take an offering during COVID, as in passing the plate. There's always a basket at the back, and an usher is going to bring it forward right now, and we'll simply say a prayer. God, we thank you for the multiple gifts with which you bless and empower us. And we pray that the gifts that we offer here or elsewhere, the gifts of our time and our talents and our treasures, including these monetary gifts, we pray that you will bless and multiply them, and that they will be used as we will be used for the mending of the world. We thank you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The carol is number 74. We're going to pray now, and if on those of you who are joining us online, I can't read if you type them in now, but if you type them in now, if you have prayer requests, keeping in mind that this is public, if you have prayer requests that you want to type into the chat, I always check the service after, and I will include your prayer requests here. Are there any? Mm-hmm. I know there are lots. Okay. Let's pray. God, thank you once again, thank you that you are among us and within us, and yet you're calling us from the streets and from the news and from places where we least expect to find you. Thank you for this wondrous story, this wondrous thing, gift that you give us over and over and over. And we've had the blessing and the privilege of one more Christmas where we get to hear it and sing it and absorb it into our hearts and our the fibers of our being. And help us live this truth that you're with us. We come to you as a thankful people, and we are so grateful for many blessings. We also come to you in prayer for the world and for specific people and situations. We pray that your world, your home, our home, that this world will turn a little more toward the light. That there will be the peace on earth and goodwill to all, of which your angels sang. And we pray that for our own living, the world will be a better place, more filled with you, more like a home to all creatures. We pray for those who are suffering in any way, people who are ill, people who are grieving, people who are exhausted. Lonely. God be with them. Help them to know how precious they are, how worthy, how beautiful and cherished. And help us to be your hands and your feet as we live our lives in a way that reaches out in the ways that we can to make that so. Be with people in places where there have been disasters, who are rebuilding. Be with those who suffer and be with those who are there to help. Be with those who are homeless right now. Be with those who are suffering from any number of things, addictions and mental health issues, financial difficulty. Help us to build a society more fair, more just, to bring in the Magnificat that Mary sang. We pray for our own families and friends now. With Bonnie, we pray for her mom. We pray for family far away. There's more than one way to be far away. We pray for any with whom we have difficult relationships. And we pray for ourselves. We offer our prayers in the name of Jesus, in trust and in hope. We pray as he taught us, as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So this isn't a Christmas carol, but it's to the point, kinda. I mean, it kinda is a Christmas carol. Anyway, December 26th, is called the Feast of Stephen. And traditionally, very traditionally, old, before it was called Boxing Day, it was a day to be kind to the poor, be generous to the poor. And so in that tradition, good King Wenceslas did what he did, and we're going to sing about that. And it's just a day. So Boxing Day is not, in fact, meant to be a day where you go rush down and see what's on sale that you can scoop up that you don't really need. And so, you know, it's a day to be generous and compassionate and kind. And so anyway, let's sing. I think this is a kind of a song. You do what you want. I'm going to sit. Okay? All right. And now, gracious God, with your faithful servant Simeon, we say, let your servants depart in peace according to your word. For our eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for the revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And with your faithful prophet Anna, let us praise God and speak about this child to all who will listen, to all who are searching. So let's go to keep watch for God and trust the promise and bless the babies and bless the parents too. Let's speak of unspeakable things, that God is turning the world upside down, and let's live in that holy place. And living there, let's confound the world together. We're going to sing one final song, and this is the last time this season, Silent Night.